We're going to look at some techniques which are commonly used for studying behavior. Just to give you an overview, through this lecture, what we're trying to do is understand and be able to construct something which is called an ecogram in behavioral studies. I'll explain all these terms to you. We should be able to differentiate between a state and an event behavior. We'll also learn some things about hypothesis testing and asking answerable questions, right? And also, we're going to do some simple exercises. So I'll be playing you some videos and we'll practice some of the methods that we learned today. Okay, just to give you an overview of how behavioral sampling came into being. The early work, when people went out to field and started collecting behavioral data, started happening in the early 1970s. And the technique at that time was just going out, finding animals and observing whatever they could see. Right? There was no standardization of methods at that point in time, which made it impossible for anybody to compare any two. Neither could we compare, nor could we contrast. And we couldn't even combine data collected from two different areas or between two different studies or between two different observers because there were no standard methods. The first and the most prominent study when it comes to studying behavior that came out was in 1974 by this lady called Jean Altman, and she published this paper in the journal Behaviour. It was titled Observational Study of Behavior, Sampling Methods. She was the first one who introduced the concept of sampling behavior, and she was the first one who also talked about avoiding bias when quantifying behavior. Okay. So, coming to why sampling is needed, why do you think we need to sample behavior? Anybody? Why not just go out into field and see whatever you feel like and just write down? And like, why not just go out, find what we find interesting and just note it down? Why do you think we need to have standard methods for studying behavior?
For comparing
people. Yeah, just what I said. Like for example, the problem with this kind of approach is, just for instance, I just went out and I saw two babblers fighting. What information is it conveying to anybody? What does it mean? Maybe, but the problem is what we don't know from this statement is how many babblers were there, okay? How did these birds interact otherwise? So I might have seen them fight, but what about the other interactions, right? I need to contrast if I'm calling something a fight. First of all, I'm not even defining what is fighting, right? There's no definition involved. And if I'm going to call it like, if I'm going to term it a fight, I don't know how it contrasts with other interactions that the two individuals were involved in other than that. And also, I'm not even reporting how long I observed it. I just went out and I just gave out a statement. So basically, it doesn't make any sense if you want to study behavior, right? So coming to the importance of standardization, as with everything else, when it comes to methods of studying birds, the choice of methods and why we need to standardize them and how we standardize them always comes down to the kind of question that you are asking. Okay? So, as Robin pointed out, as Umesh pointed out, the technique has to be chosen with respect to what you are interested in finding out. Now, let's look at this question. Are male purple sunbirds more aggressive than females? Now, can you tell me if it's an answerable question? Yeah? How will you answer this? So what I'm saying is that basically this is a very vague question. Can you suggest ways of making it more answerable?
More specific.
Right? More specific.
Define more.
Yeah, right. So yeah, we are going to be doing exercises to do exactly this. But for example, for this particular question, a better way of asking this question could be one of these questions, right? On an average, do males spend more of the day involved in aggressive behaviors than do females? right? This is something that you can actually quantify. Is that clear?
Yes.
Do you agree with me?
Yes.
Yeah? Or you could also ask, do males initiate aggressive bouts more often than do females? Right? Is this more measurable?
Yes.
Yeah? You can also ask, are the aggressive acts of males more serious, more intense, or potentially more destructive? You can even ask, is the response to an aggressive act more likely to be aggressive act if the recipient is a male? So basically, we broke down a very vague question, which was not really answerable, into questions that actually can be answered, right? So when you are designing a behavioral study, the first thing is to actually think about the question, right? And it shouldn't be as vague as that. Or even if you start with something like that, you have to finally boil down to a question where you identify what you're going to measure, okay? Only then can we start thinking of how do we measure that, right? First, we have to come to the what. What are we going to measure? And once you have figured that out, then we can think of appropriate methods to quantify that, okay? So this is just to stress again and again on the importance of asking the right questions to begin with, okay? So before you hit the field, in any ecological study, your question should be something like that, which can be actually measured, right? And once you decide what the question is and what you're going to measure, then we can think of what method, what techniques we can use. So some of the methods described in that paper by Jean Orman, that includes something called ad libitum sampling, which is what is like, you know, just going out, observing without much framework or anything and just taking notes. So for example, if I want you to just go out and study a panda, I'm just telling you, just go out and bring back a time activity budget of a panda, right? What do you do first?
Find a panda,
and you have to really watch it in its natural habitat and really define different behaviors, right? And to do that, unless you just go and spend a lot of time just watching the animal, you won't be able to get to a stage where you know what to measure, right? So the first thing for any unknown species which has not been studied previously is to go and do ad libitum sampling, okay? Then there is something called focal animal sampling. Where basically you focus on one individual and you observe it over a length of time, predecided length of time. How we do it, I'll get to the details later. Then you can also sample all occurrences of some specific behavior. So basically you watch an individual, you decide that this is the behavior that I'm interested in. You watch it for a predefined amount of time and note down how many times that individual engaged in that behavior. So you get a frequency. You can also sample sequences. For example, I studied leaf warblers for my master's. So, and I was interested in quantifying their foraging behavior. So I wanted to know how they are foraging. So I already knew the definitions of the foraging behavior. So if it does this kind of thing, it had a name. So there were some three different behaviors I was interested in. And what I used to do is, once I located a warbler, I used to follow it for 10 feeding events. So, and every time I used to note down what it did. So when you do that kind of sampling, it's called sequence sampling. Then there is also 1-0 sampling, where you observe and see if it did a certain behavior or not. And finally, instantaneous and scan sampling. So that's also, I'll get to it. Basically what you do is you scan all individuals in a group and then you basically record what each individual was doing at that point in time. Okay? So these are some of the basic or more important methods described in the study. And to date, we have been following this very well. There have not been many major changes with respect to the approaches that we adopt for studying behavior since that study. Okay, and coming to the two types of behavior that you need to be very clear about. One is a state. A state is basically a long-term behavior which is usually measured in terms of the duration. So for example, resting. How long was it resting? So it's not like one-time event. It basically, any behavior which is associated, which continues over a long period of time, it's a state. On the other hand, or even like for example, amount of like a bird when it forages also, it spends a measurable amount of time, right? So then also it becomes a state. On the other hand, short-term behaviors are something, other kind of behaviors which are rarer than states and also happen very fast, okay? So for those kinds of events, what we instead measure is the frequency. So in a certain amount of time, how many times did it occur? For example, how many times did a bird call during this time? Or for example, even this aggression, if it's just like an aggressive, some, you know, gesture in a certain predefined amount of time, how many times did it do it? Okay, then it becomes an event. Is everyone clear about the difference between states and events? Yeah, we need to understand it because you guys are going to do some exercises, so we have to be very clear about everything. Okay, so the first step, once you have gone out and found your animal, is to do ad libitum observations. And the objective of doing such ad libitum observations is to make something called an ethogram. Okay, so before you can measure behavior, what you need to do is make an exhaustive list of behaviors that species or individual engages in. Okay, so basically what you do is you define every behavior that can be characterized based on your observation, and for each of these behaviors you have to come up with a very clear definition. Okay, because we want to make it objective, right? It shouldn't be something that you are calling it resting, I am calling it moving, or, you know, it shouldn't be vague, we shouldn't be ambiguous about it. So an ethogram is basically, it describes all the behaviors, okay, and you can also differentiate them between states and events. Okay, so the same thing here is normal and aggressive in this case for a bird, they have just categorized them into that, but you can also divide them into states and events. And for each of them, you should have a verbal definition. Okay, and if, say for example, a group of you are doing an behavioral study together, you must make sure that all of you agree on the definition. So that when you are recording it, two people should not record it differently. Right, so it's always, so ethogram basically has written definitions for every behavior. And you have to make like an exhaustive list of whatever that individual or species does. Everything must be noted down. And what is often advised is that you should have other and out of view as two of the states. For example, if the animal that you are viewing is not there, just goes behind a bush or something, what do you write? So it's good to have these other or out of view as one category so that all those observations can be put under that category. Okay? So for example, this was a study where basically the question was, how does anti-predator responses of great tits differ across disturbed and undisturbed habitat? This is what you are interested in studying. First, what you have to do is make an ethogram. And do you need to make an ethogram of everything? Maybe not, right? You're only interested in anti-predator behavior. So basically, whenever it sees a predator, the kind of mobbing and alarm behavior that it engages in, you are interested in making an ethogram about all of that. So this is an example ethogram, and you can just see it is so well described, right? So behavior category, what is the behavior, whether you detected it using visual cues or using vocalization, and then there is a description associated with that, right? So you have to, for any behavioral study, this is what you begin with, yeah, a good ethogram. Coming to focal animal sampling, focal animal sampling is when we observe an individual or a smaller subgroup within a larger group or population and record all the activities that it does within a predefined amount of time. So you can do focal animal sampling for 10 minutes, we're just going to watch a particular individual for 10 minutes and you record every event. So if it's an event, you just write, okay, get it. You can just write one against that category. If you are measuring a state, then you should have a stopwatch, because you have to measure the amount of time that it is doing that. So if it's a bird walking, then you have to measure how long it's walking. If it's feeding, then you have to measure how long it does that. So you need a stopwatch to measure the duration for every state variable, right? And the most important thing in a focal animal sampling is you have to identify the bird, because you have to follow it. So it's very difficult to do it, say for example in this. Unless the bird has a ring, in such similar looking birds, it's very difficult. A lot of behavioral studies, for instance, in our countries have been done on primates. So they use a lot of characteristics like facial scars or some other injury mark or length of the tail or something like that to mark the individual, like basically identify the individual, because you'll be following it for that entire 10-minute duration. So it's more appropriate. So in case you're dealing with a species, like for example, even in this case, it might be really difficult to follow it. Like as they move around, it looks just the same as the other ones. So it might not be the best technique to study behavior in this species. Okay, and so basically, this particular method is useful for measuring both states and events, right? Because you're looking at the individual for a long time. And it's also the best method for observing interactions, because as you're following it, whoever that individual is interacting with, you can record that. If you're looking at just state, I will come to the instantaneous scans, you will find out why it's difficult there. And it's also, it presents a more unbiased record of behavior if you choose your animal without any bias. Like for example, if you reach a place and you find if you are biased in your selection of individual, like then of course there's a bias associated with that. But if you choose the individual randomly, then this is a very unbiased way of recording behavior. The second method that often is used is called an instantaneous or scan sampling. What happens here is you have this large group, you just scan from one end of the group to the other, and for every individual, you just note down what it is doing at this particular time that you watch it. And then basically just scan, basically you just look at it and just keep moving on. So you just note down with what activity was it doing at that particular time. And as is obvious, you don't need to identify the individual in this case, right? Because you're just moving from one end of the group to the other. But this is useful only for recording states, not events. The problem is the chances that you come across an event during a scan is very, very rare. So it doesn't work very well. And it's very useful when you have to monitor large group of living species. So every scan that you do, you write down how many individuals you have. Basically, you're trying to arrive at, in that case, you're trying to arrive at some average for the group. Because you can't identify individuals, right? So you're just coming up with a average for the group in that case. So to compare these two methods, just imagine that this is your time duration. 20 minutes, okay? And let's say that these blue dashes represent episodes of resting, when the individual was resting. And all these hatches that you have represent 10-second intervals, right? So if you do continuous sampling, you'll record this, the duration of all these resting events, okay? Because you have a stopwatch with you. When you started resting, ended resting, you noted it down. So you are getting all these time durations. It adds up to about 650 seconds out of the 1200 seconds or 20 minutes that you spend doing it. So you get 54% as the amount of time that that individual spent resting in that case. Okay. Now in contrast, just imagine that you are doing instantaneous sampling. Okay. So you are basically looking at the individuals. During the same time frame, you looked at it 10 times. Sorry, 20 times. You did 20. So every place there's a hatch is when you looked at the individual, right? So basically every 10 seconds, you just glimpsed at the individual. So wherever it overlapped with the resting period, you recorded it as sleeping. Where it didn't, you basically didn't record it as sleeping, right? In this case, what you did was, the way you calculate the proportion of time resting is, how many scans out of those 20 scans did you find it resting? So that comes out to be 50% because you got it in 10 out of 20 times. Okay, now just imagine you just did 10 scans. Last time you did 20 scans, this time you just did 10 scans. In that case, you are missing much more. Okay, now when you calculate the amount of resting, it's coming out to be only 40%, when actually it was 54%. So what happens is basically, if you do scan sampling very frequently, it almost matches with continuous sampling. Yeah? But as you increase the duration between scans, it will be more and more different from the actual data. Is this clear for everyone?
Yes.
Now we'll look at one of the most common things calculated in most behavioral studies is time activity budget, which is basically an individual or a group, how much time does it devote to different activities? Feeding, wrestling, locomotion, vocalization, all these activities, how much time does it spend in doing all these activities? So if you are getting samples using continuous sampling or focal animal sampling, the way you calculate time activity budget is basically calculate the number of seconds or minutes or whatever for each of your entry. So you are going to take down the time associated with each activity. Then you add up the duration under each activity, and then you divide it by the total amount of time that you did spend in observation. And in case of events, so this is for states because you are noting down the time. In terms of events, you just count the number of occurrences of that event during your entire sampling period. Okay? And so based on this, so basically for states, you get the time activity budget. Okay, when you do scan sampling to get at the same thing, what you do is count the number of scans when a certain activity occurred and divide by the total number of scans that you did. Okay? So depending on the method that you used for getting at the behavior, this is how you compute. So in every case, it's going to be a percentage. The percentage of time spent or the percentage of whatever samples that you looked at, scans that you looked at. Okay. Now, these are questions for you. So for example, the question is, does size of flower influence the time spent foraging in crimson sunbird? What do you think would be an appropriate way to sample for that, to get at that? Yeah, why? Exactly. So, because we are interested in knowing that if there is a correlation between the size of flower and the amount of time it is spending foraging, so we need the duration. So, in that case, it will be better to do continuous sampling, right? And for example, you have a question: does human activity influence the foraging behavior of godwits, which are waders?
Scan.
Okay, so we can scan, and what do we do with that?
Number of times it gets affected by the.
Yeah? Anybody else? So, of course, scan sampling is the more appropriate thing to do here because you can't identify individuals and you can't follow them. And also, we are dealing with groups, right? A group. So, what do you think we should do? So we know the technique, but how are we going to get at the difference? What? Yeah. The first thing I actually pointed out is we have to find areas with varying levels of human disturbances to begin with. We should have flocks in less disturbed areas and we should have flocks in more disturbed areas. That's the first step. Then what do we do?
One without any disturbance.
Yeah.
Control.
That's the control.
Scan each flock at different time intervals.
Yeah.
Count the number of scans when they are affected by the human activity, human behavior.
So the thing is that in this case, because we really don't know what might be effective, what might be a good way to go about this is go and build time activity budgets in disturbed and undisturbed areas. Okay, because then we'll get an idea of how much time it is devoting to different activities in both these areas. Then we can compare for each of the activities and say if something is really changing, right? Yeah? Okay. Is that clear?
Yes.
Yeah? We will end at this.